Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning to those who are here. We've probably got about 20 people in the church, all in their household groups and self-isolating. It's good to see those who are here, and good to welcome those who are watching at home too. And on behalf of the church, we want to wish everyone a very happy new year. This is the first all-age service for 2021. And I think it would be good if we just recognize that we've got people watching at home who can't be with us. So let's just say to one another and to everyone at home, Happy New Year. All right, after three, one, two, three, Happy New Year. Great. If you're like me, you're probably quite happy we've got through 2020 relatively unscathed. And we certainly don't want a repeat of that year again, do we? But it's behind us now. And it's as if in our life story, we've opened a new chapter. The pages are empty. God will help us write what the story will be. But often the new year is an opportunity for us to just stop, take stock, see where we are, think about the past, and think about the future. And it's often a time when we might think about making some new year resolutions, making some promises to ourselves about things that we want to achieve in 2021. And this morning, I'd like us to think about three New Year resolutions I might ask you to put in place for 2021. And for those at home, just to remind you that it's our monthly breaking of bread or communion time, and this will take place at the end of our normal service. So if at home you want to get some bread and some drink, appropriate drink ready, but you'd be very welcome to share with us in that time together when we take bread and wine in remembrance of the Lord Jesus. But we're going to start now with a hymn, and you can keep your seats for this one. And it's one I expect you perhaps thought I would choose. It's Lord for the Years. Lord for the Years Your Love Has Kept and Guided. So let's sit and listen to this hymn sung by a nice choir.
Thank you.
I thought it would be good if we had some positive things to think about for the new year. And so I've chosen some Bible verses that bring something positive for us, things that we can hold on to in difficult times. And Josh and Abby are going to come up and read these verses to us. So if you'd like to come up, Josh and Abby, that would be great. The mic is on. It's on, yep. So if you could read your verses twice, just so that everybody gets a chance to think about them and understand them.
Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. The Lord says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. The Lord says, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand."
Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. Moses says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you or forsake you." Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. Moses says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you or forsake you."
Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future."
John 14, verse 27. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." John 14, verse 27. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid."
Thank you very much. Hopefully there's something in those verses that we can keep hold of. Several of them along the theme of, although difficulties and dangers are being faced, God is with us and will see us through. And I like that verse from John 14 where Jesus says he leaves his peace with us and therefore we need not be afraid. The fact that we are Christians, that we believe in a loving God, we have the Lord Jesus, a loving Saviour, that can make all the difference in these difficult times. And we're going to just give our thanks and our praise to God now as we come in prayer and we bring our thanksgivings and worship. Let's pray, shall we? Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we do give thanks for all those years that you have loved and provided and guided us. And here we are at the start of a new year. We acknowledge, Heavenly Father, that you are the great God, the one who is sovereign over all time. You are indeed eternal, without beginning and without end. And yet, Heavenly Father, we can know you as our Father. We can know you as one who loves and cares for us, who has a love and care for this world and this universe that you have created. So much so that in the affairs of mankind, you have intervened in days gone by, and you still want to intervene today, for you have given that wonderful provision of a Savior in the Lord Jesus. We've been thinking so much about his birth over the last few weeks, and we recognize the wonderful purpose and plan behind his coming. As the scripture says, you, the Father, sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And a song has reminded us about our world, lost indeed without you, hungry and helpless. And we want to pray for our world today. And we ask, Heavenly Father, you will look down in mercy on us, on our country, the world, the countries around us, on the wider world. We are a needy world at the moment with this pandemic that's raging right around the world and in many societies. We want to ask, Heavenly Father, for an alleviation of this trouble. We want to ask that whether it's through miraculous ways or through the efforts of scientists to make this vaccine available, we pray that this vaccine might be effective in dealing with this horrible, invisible infection that we're all very aware of. We just ask, Heavenly Father, that through it all, those who are believers in the Lord Jesus might show love, care, and compassion. We give thanks for what we've seen in our own country, with those who have reached out to those in need, and we give thanks for this. And we pray that as believers in the Lord Jesus, we too will play our part in that. We ask for the furtherance of the gospel, the good news of Jesus, that many will come to see beyond the everyday issues of this life, there is an eternal life to be reckoned with too. That they will recognize that the Lord Jesus can bless not only that time, but the present time too. He said that he had come to bring life, life in all its fullness. And we ask that many who are in darkness might see his light and come to him, we pray. We ask that you'll be with us as we continue in our service this morning. May it be good for us to be here or to be viewing this service. May it do us good as we stand on this threshold of a new year, we pray. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So, our Bible reading today is Hebrews chapter 12, and it's verses 1 to 3. Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 3. I'm going to put it on the screen and read it to you. The writer is saying, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. That's our reading for today, and it's from these verses I'm going to pick out three New Year resolutions for you. And they will also help us as we move into our time of communion and remembrance of the Lord Jesus. Now, a kid's spot for today. It was going to be a teen spot. We haven't got very many teens here, so it'll have to be adults as well in our teen spot. Now, our Bible reading spoke about running in a race. And I wonder what race that is. Well, we've got a race runner here today as our special guest. So, here he comes. Good morning. Good morning. We ought not to have shaken hands, ought we? But you have got your gloves on, so that's all right. This is Mr. Sciple. Mr. Sciple. He's got an initial. He's actually Mr. Disciple.
That's right.
Is that right?
That's right,
Mr.
Yes.
Mr. Disciple. Right, well, we're glad to have you here.
It's good to be here.
So, I can see you're very fit and a good runner.
Absolutely, yes.
Yes.
I'm in training.
You're in training, that's great. Now, what's this race that you're in, actually?
Have you not heard?
No.
I mean, this is the world's biggest.
Is it?
Yeah, absolutely. This is the Christian life race we're talking about.
A Christian life race?
Absolutely.
Oh, that must have been what the writer in the Hebrews was talking about, was it?
I suspect so.
Running the race?
Yes, yes.
And are there many other runners in this race?
Absolutely. You wouldn't believe this race.
Yeah?
There are over 2 billion in this race. Social distancing is almost impossible.
How do you start this Christian race then?
Oh, that's a good question. To start this race, there's a point where you have to let Jesus be in control of your life as your saviour, and you commit your life to him from that point onwards.
Wow. But how about, how long does this race last then?
This is a long one.
Ah.
It lasts until the end of your life.
Oh.
That could be many years. We're not talking about a sprint here, we're talking about a marathon.
But our Bible reading said that in running this Christian life race, it's possible not to run very well sometimes.
Is that so?
Yeah. Do you think that's right? It says that sometimes there are things that come into our running of the race that can sort of hinder us and stop us running. In fact, one of the Bible verses talks about, Bible translation talks about carrying weights that are going to hold us back.
Do you think? We can give it a try.
Shall we give it a try?
Let's give it a try.
Right.
What do you got for me?
Right, well, I think the first thing you need is some new shoes.
Okay, I'm up for that, yeah.
Yeah, how about putting one of these on there? You need one of these if it gets a bit wet and muddy.
Just the one?
Just the one, just the one. Yeah, we'll just have one, shall we?
The wrong shoe. Never mind, right, let's put that all back on.
Oh, sorry.
Okay.
Do you think that will help your running?
I'm not convinced, but what else we've got.
Oh, right. Well, what about a nice heavy coat? Oh dear, this is really heavy.
Where did you get this? Oh. I know it's cold weather at the moment, but...
Do you think that would help you running?
It's a bit restrictive.
Is it a bit heavy?
Yeah, and the weight's not great. I'm used to my lightweight one.
Oh.
I can't find the zip. There we go.
You're going to need some water on your running, so... Ready? How about these? How about carrying these with you as you go? You think that would work? Oh!
Oh, hang on. Okay, well, it's a little tough. I could try a squat and see how...
All right, try a squat and see how it works. Can you get up? Let me help you up. Good. Well done, Mr. Disciple. Well done.
But I'm not sure I can run.
Give it a try. Whoa. I think you can put them down now.
Okay.
So I gave you things that sort of stopped you running, didn't I? Stopped you running well.
You did a good job of that, yeah.
Yes, I did that.
Yeah, I'm not doing much running.
Yeah. What about in the Christian life race? What sort of things might weigh us down, might stop us running well? Let me have the Wellington boot and we'll see what that might represent. Thank you. Oh. Well, one of the weights that we might stop us running well would be if we stop coming to church. Because it's coming to church that helps us to be with other Christians and can help us to remind ourselves that we are followers of Jesus and we can learn how to follow him. And if we stop coming to church or bothering with it, it won't help us run the Christian race very well, will it? What about these heavy weights here? What might these represent? What might these stop us doing? Well, this might be stopping us if we stop reading our Bibles. This might be if we stop praying. If we stop reading our Bibles and we stop praying, that's not going to help us on our Christian life, is it? If we're not reading our Bibles, we're not understanding what God wants to say to us. And if we're not praying, we're not talking to him. If we don't pray, it's like coming home and not saying anything to your mum and dad. And they ask you, do you have a good day? And you go, what do you want for your tea? Is anything troubling you? Doesn't work, does it? And so when we pray, we're talking to God. like we might talk to our parents. And we can ask him to help us. And we can tell him that we think he's great. He's a great big God. What about that jacket? Thank you. Well, this might be having the wrong sort of friends. Now, I know some of you are a bit smaller for that, but sometimes as you get older, it's really good to have friends, and you like having friends, friends at school or something like that. And they can be all right, as long as you've got the right sort of friends. Because sometimes I've known people who've grown up as Christians, and they've got in with the wrong sort of friends. And the friends say to them, you don't want to go to church. Church is for losers. You don't want to bother with the Bible. It's all made up. And you sort of think, well, if I'm going to stay their friends, I'll have to do what they do. I'll have to think the way they think. And they can stop us running the Christian race. And I've known people who have started off really well as Christians, but they got in with the wrong sort of friends. Instead of coming to church, they go out with their friends. And they go to things that are not wrong in themselves, but not very helpful. They go to football matches or something on the Sunday, or they go shopping on the Sunday, or other things like that. Not bad in themselves, but it stops them running the Christian race very well. So can you remember that there are things that we've got to throw off, things that we've got to leave behind? We've got to be careful and make sure we run the Christian race really well, because it's how we finish that's going to count at the end. So thank you very much, Mr. Disciple.
Thank you. It feels so much better to be without
those
weights.
Without all that stuff hanging on.
I was hoping we might be able to do some welly-wanging to really throw off
no,
the weights.
No. We say goodbye.
Yes.
Enjoy the race.
I'm off to run.
Thank you.
See you later.
We're going to be thinking a lot about running today. When we come to church on a Sunday, we see lots of runners. I don't know if you see them around here, but you know, people are really keen. And it'd be great if we were keen to run the Christian race just like they are in their physical races. We're going to sing another song that's appropriate for a New Year's Day. It's Great is Thy Faithfulness. So we can sit and listen to this song.
Shadow of turning with thee.
I'm going to stop it. Can I go back? No, I can't. Yes, there we are. Now, we've had that as in the traditional, nice choral singing. Now, I found Great is Thy Faithfulness with a little bit more up-tempo and with some actions. So I'm going to ask you to stand now, and we'll have a go at hearing Great is Thy Faithfulness. You can sing it into your masks, and you can have a go at the actions, all right? So let's see how we get on. So stand if you want to, and help you stretch your legs. Let's see if I can get it there. Oh, sorry, I'm mucking about here. Don't know how Alan's coping at the back. Here we are. In the church, be seated. Hope you had a go at home. Great is thy faithfulness. A good message to take forward into the new year, that God is faithful no matter what. Now I think it's probably time for the youngsters to go upstairs to the explorers group, so we'll say goodbye to them from the church here as they go up to their session upstairs. So we're going to think together this morning about three New Year resolutions from these verses in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 3 that we've read together. And we've already raised the illustration that in these verses, the writer talks about running the Christian life like a race, with a beginning, a middle, and an end. It's not so much a sprint, is it? As Mr. Disciple told us, it's more like a marathon. I thought perhaps it's more like the steeplechase race. You remember seeing those? I think the steeplechase is about 3,000 meters or something like that round the track. But what makes it different is rather than running smoothly around the track, you have four hurdles or barriers you have to jump over, and you have a water jump. And if you've seen them doing the steeplechase, when they come to the water jump, the idea is you jump with one foot on the barrier, one foot in the water, and you keep on going. The Christian life can sometimes feel a bit like that, can't it? Lots of obstacles and difficulties in the way. And as we've said, sometimes they come from ourselves, sometimes they come from outside, but they can make our progress a bit slow and difficult. Not many of us have a smooth run in our Christian lives, do we? It's not always a smooth track. But we shouldn't be surprised, because that was never promised to followers of Jesus. But here we are in 2021, and we're starting, if you like, on a new lap on the race. And so were the Hebrews, in a sense. They were facing some real obstacles and difficulties. One of the prime things that the writer to the Hebrews is trying to remind them of and persuade them about is they were being influenced as Hebrew Christians to fall back into the old Jewish ways, to follow the Jewish law, to follow all the regulations about special days and all the sacrifices and things like this. And the writer is saying to them, no, we have our fullness in Jesus. We don't want to go back into the old ways. They're deficient. They've been set aside, and now we have something new coming along in Jesus. And he wants to encourage them and us to overcome the obstacles and to keep going on the Christian life race. And as we look ahead, who would have guessed that this time last year in 2020, any of us would have thought of how the year would actually turn out? And none of us know how the current year is going to turn out. We're faced with this uncertainty. But within that, I'd like to suggest that there are three New Year resolutions that we might put into effect this year. Here's the first one. I will keep the weight off. I will keep the weight off. No, I'm not going to be talking about starting a new diet, all right? And I'm not looking at anyone in particular to say you ought to start on the new diet, all right? But it is very topical. Just in yesterday's Daily Mail, 30-day health kick, day by day to transform your life. And one of the key things is what you should eat, how you should diet. Now, it's not bad advice that we should keep our physical weight down. I read that 67% of men and 60% of women are overweight. I'm not looking at anyone here, but that's quite a high proportion of the people who are here, isn't it? So keeping an eye on our weight can certainly, as we know, be physically beneficial. But what I'm getting at is the impact in our Christian lives of things that hold us back in the Christian life. Things that hold us back in our race. Things that loosen our relationship with God and may even stop, as we've said, our Christian lives from progressing. In verse 1 of our reading, in the King James Version, it says, lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily besets us. Laying aside the weight. That's my resolution. I'm going to keep the weight off. I'm going to look at what is in my life, what's coming into my life, and make sure it's not weighing me down and stopping me running the Christian race very well. We've talked about some of the things that can hinder us in our Christian life. When I spoke with the children earlier, things like stopping reading our Bibles, stopping praying, not being involved or coming to church, having the wrong sorts of contact. But can I just add a couple more of things to look out for in our Christian life race? The first one is the story of Demas. Have you heard about him? He was one of Paul in the New Testament, the great missionary, one of his close associates. And Paul speaks warmly of him in the early letters. But by the time he gets to 2 Timothy chapter 4, probably the last letter he wrote, he says there about Demas, Demas has deserted me because he loved this world. That's rather sad, isn't it? His running of the Christian life race had come to an end, as it were, because he'd found something else to take its place that he thought was more attractive, that was perhaps easier. He loved this present world. He put aside his Christian life that he might enjoy everything that the world had to offer. And we need to be careful too that our faith and the demonstration of it doesn't slip away to be replaced by other, more attractive things. A second thing that we might be careful of is sinful thoughts and actions. Sinful thoughts and actions. This can be a real, these can be an obstacle for us, even as Christians. Very easy to let the wrong attitudes fester in our minds, to do the wrong sort of actions, to say the wrong sort of words. It can be very subtle, but it can be like a rope that entangles a runner. And in our verses, it spoke about not letting sin entangle us, stopping us from running the race that we should. We need to be careful and have that self-appraisal in our lives just to make sure that things aren't creeping in that ought not to be there. Often the end of the year and the beginning of a new one is time for a stock check. And perhaps it's been quite a difficult year for us if we were to do a stock check of our Christian lives and where we're at. We've had limited contact with church. Some of you haven't been in the building or been close to other members of the church family for many months. And that's just the way it has been, and we've had to cope with it, haven't we? But it's very easy for us to slip. But let's be aware of our shortcomings and determined, with the Lord's help, I'm going to keep the weights off. I'm going to keep running well. Here's the second resolution. I will keep checking my vision. I will keep checking my vision. Well, to think of the weights and throwing them off is a bit negative, but our verses also give us a positive advice on running the Christian life well. And it said this, didn't it? Fix your eyes on Jesus. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith. Again, it's good to have your vision checked. I've been pleased to go to the opticians at times because he's diagnosed issues from my eyes, like my high cholesterol shown in my eyes, that the doctor was able to put right, or to write and ask for my cataracts to be sorted out. It's good to check our vision, but even better to check our spiritual vision. Are you fixing your eyes on Jesus? Is Jesus in our focus? Is he in our minds and our thoughts? Do we only ever think about him on Sundays? There's a danger for us that our vision gets deflected and we forget to fix our eyes on Jesus. I was thinking of an illustration from my school days. We had a school sports day. I can remember it very clearly. I must have been 9 or 10, I guess, still up in Scotland. And we had the traditional, you know, the class in a line, and there's a finishing line, and it's a sprint to get to the end. And my father was there watching for the sports day. And actually, I was doing pretty well. I was probably almost in the front, he said. And I can remember it very clearly, thinking, I'm going to do pretty well in this. But then I suddenly was aware of somebody just behind me, and I sort of looked around to see where they were, and I sort of stumbled. And they run past me and got to the line first. And my father said, if you hadn't looked behind and kept your eyes ahead, you would probably have won. And that's an illustration for us, isn't it? If we keep on looking ahead and fixing our eyes on Jesus, that will make all the difference for us. The finishing line will be when he calls us to himself and takes us to heaven. And the Bible says then, we'll see him as he is. We have completely clear 100% vision of Jesus. Until then, we can fix our eyes on, spiritual eyes on him, and make sure we go on following him. Part of this resolution, keeping checking my vision, might be that we make some time every day just to think about Jesus. Perhaps we could start reading one of the Gospels. just a bit every day, just to help us fix our eyes on Jesus. And as we take our eyes off of ourselves and our own circumstances and the problems and obstacles in front of us, it will help us to keep making progress and keep things in perspective, because we've got an eternal life that we need to keep in perspective as well. Here's the third resolution. I will keep on keeping on no matter what. I will keep on keeping on no matter what. In our verses from Hebrews, the writer says to his readers, let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Quite interesting that, isn't it? The race marked out for us. I take that to mean that the race you're running may actually be different to the race I'm running. The track that you're on may be different to the track that God has laid out for me to run. But God wants us to have this perseverance, as the writer put it. We might call it endurance. Another word might be grit. He wants us to endure, to persevere, to keep on keeping on, even though it's difficult at times. The danger is that we grow weary and lose heart, he says. I don't know about you, but I felt that at times in my Christian life. Sometimes it seems so difficult, doesn't it? Things don't work out as we hope. We put a lot of effort into Christian things, but nothing seems to happen. But in these circumstances, when we're feeling like that, we've got to persevere. We've got to keep on going. And perhaps that's the sort of attitude that we need to have. In the Hebrew verses that we read, he says, I want to remind you, Hebrews, that we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. I wonder what he means by that. Well, I think perhaps he had in mind the athletic stadium. You know, we're in the Olympic Games, and all around the stadium are these individuals who are looking on. But these aren't spectators. He doesn't say, you know, we're surrounded by a great crowd of spectators. He said we're surrounded by a great crowd of witnesses. And what we're surrounded by are these individuals who have proved in their life and experience that faith in God works and that you can run the Christian life. And I think what the writer's got in mind, because he started our little Bible reading with the word therefore, he's looking back to chapter 11. And in chapter 11, we've got these great heroes of faith. You know, people like Noah and Abraham and others like that. And I think what he's saying is, if we look into what's around us, the lives of people around us, if we look into our Bibles and we see the way that people are an example, a witness to us of God's goodness and faithfulness, that can be an encouragement to us too. That's why Bible reading can be important. And so we've got witnesses around, people who have proved God's faithfulness. And it's not only from heroes of faith in the past. We can look to those who are more recent, people who have shown by their life that they've run the Christian life race despite obstacles, and they've proven the goodness and faithfulness of God. They ran with perseverance and got to the end safely. What if we do struggle? What if we do find the race and the way difficult? Let's have a look at this interesting video. It's about a runner, a UK runner called Derek Redmond. And it comes from the Olympic Games 400 meters semi-final in Barcelona. And you'll see what happens as he runs his race. Seems to be going off okay. But then he pulls up, he's damaged a muscle in his leg. race goes on and the other runners finish. But he's determined to finish too. He's obviously struggling. Out of the crowd, somebody comes to help him, pushes his way past the officials. Together they get over the line. It's only later that we're told that the man who came to help was his own father. You take the point. He finished the race with his father's help. With God's help, if we seek it, he will help us to run our race and to finish well. So whatever 2021 brings to us, let's keep on running our Christian lives race. The Apostle Paul had something to say about this as he came towards the end of his life. He says in 2 Timothy, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." What a great testimony, and may that be ours too. Please have a think about these three resolutions. Let's keep the weight off in our Christian lives. Let's keep checking our vision so that we're fixing our eyes on Jesus. Let's keep on keeping on, no matter what. We're going to have a song. It's really a song of commitment. It's called "Another Year is Dawning." It's an older hymn written by Francis Ridley Havergal, who wrote quite a number of the gospel hymns that we used to sing. And perhaps this is a prayer that you can pray too.
Working or in waiting, another year we've
to close this section with a prayer. Ask that God will help us to run our race patiently and with perseverance. Let's pray. And then we'll move into our time of communion. Oh God, our Heavenly Father, we ask that you will help us to make this another year for thee. Help it to be a year of progress in our Christian lives. Help us to overcome any obstacles that are placed before us in that race. Help us to run with perseverance. Though no matter what comes our way, we can keep on keeping on, knowing that you are with us, your Holy Spirit is alongside us, and will take us through to the end. Help us to keep out those things in our lives that can be a disadvantage to us, that can hinder us in our Christian life and progress. Help us, we pray, to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. So bless us for being here. Bless everyone who's been watching at home. Bless these words, the sermon to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to move to the breaking of bread now. And let me just say a few words just to focus our attention on what we're doing and the one that we're remembering here today. What we're doing as we take bread and wine is we're remembering the Lord Jesus. And we're doing really just what the verse asked us to do. We're fixing our eyes on Jesus. We have a physical way of remembering him by taking bread and wine. And our verse reminded us of how he responded when the crisis came in his race, as it were. You remember the verse, "For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of God." The cross was endured, linked with all the shame and humiliation that was heaped upon him. And we're asked in those same verses to consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men. I thought of the verse from the hymn, "Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a savior." And then a few moments of quiet as we take the bread and wine. Let's do as we were asked to do in our verse and consider him. And later, if in 2021 our lives become really tough and a struggle, let's take the Lord Jesus as our greatest example and keep persevering. For as he found, after the struggle, there was joy. There was delight. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. His eyes weren't just on the cross. They were looking ahead to the fact that he would be welcomed back to the Father's side and given that place of honor at the Father's right hand. And one day, because of the cross that he endured, because of his resurrection and ascension and where he is now, one day he will take us to be with himself there. And we will worship him as we ought. I've chosen a song to help us to consider Jesus. There's no music, just the words. I'd like to suggest I read the verses. And we can all hear, and at home if you'd like to, quietly, behind our masks or at home, say the chorus each time. It's the song, "Come and See, Come and See." Let me read the verse, and when we come to the chorus, we'll read it all together. "Come and see, come and see, come and see the King of Love. See the purple robe and crown of thorns he wears. Soldiers mock, rulers sneer, as he lifts the cruel cross. Lone and friendless now, he climbs towards the hill." All together. "We worship at your feet, where love and mercy meet, and a guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. For us he was made sin. Oh, help me take it in. Deep wounds of love cry out, Father, forgive. I worship the Lamb who was slain. Come and weep, come and mourn for your sin that pierced him there, so much deeper than the wounds of thorn and nail. All our pride, all our greed, all our fallenness and shame, and the Lord has laid the punishment on him. And together, we worship at your feet, where wrath and mercy meet, and a guilty world is washed by love's pure stream. For us he was made sin. Oh, help me take it in. Deep wounds of love cry out, Father, forgive. I worship the Lamb who was slain. I'm going to ask Gordon here for those in the church to distribute the little capsules that we have. For those of you who are interested at home, this is what they look like. And they have a little, they're all sealed. They have a seal at the top. And underneath there's a little disc of unleavened bread, another seal, and there's a little bit of wine underneath. So Gordon, if you'd like to distribute those, then I'll give thanks for the bread. And we'll then take the bread together that we have. Let me just give thanks in prayer for what this bread reminds us of. Lord Jesus, we do worship you. We do remember that the cross that you endured and your body there was broken and given for us. And you asked us to remember you in this physical way of taking this bread, and this we do now. We give thanks indeed for your love that led you to that cross. We thank you for your obedience that put you there. We thank you for the wonderful provision that has been made for our salvation in the giving of yourself as that one sacrifice for sins forever. We take this bread now. We take it with thanksgiving in our hearts and with praise and worship to you, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. We give thanks for the wine too. Reminds us of the precious blood of the Lord Jesus that was poured out and given for us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we take this wine which reminds us of your precious blood that was outpoured. The verse of the hymn that I've quoted, "Sealed my pardon with his blood," is so true. The blood had to be shed as that once and for all sacrifice for sin. Bible reminds us that without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, there's no forgiveness. But you did shed your blood. You did give your life as that sacrifice. There at the cross, you bore our sins in your body on the tree. The Lord laid on you the iniquity of us all, but you endured that cross. We praise you that you knew joy that was set before you. We praise you that you are risen, that you are glorified, that you are sat down at the right hand of God, having completed the work that he gave you to do. We thank you this was a once and for all sacrifice that was made for sin and for salvation. And we praise you that we have come into the good of it. We want to bring you our thanks and our praise, Lord Jesus, and to own before you that we owe it all to you. And we praise you and thank you for your love and care for us. Accept of our thanks, we would ask in your name. Amen. Let's drink together. We've come to the close of our service. Thank you for being here. Thank you for watching online. May God bless our time together and bless us as we have this new year ahead of us. Let's remember to be kind to one another in these difficult times. Kind to ourselves, kind to one another too. Can I remind you, we have a Zoom online prayer meeting tonight at 8 o'clock, and you should have had details sent out to you. And if you can join us for that, that would be really good. And to remind you too that on Thursday we restart our house groups online. I've got to do the questions, but at least I know what the speaker spoke about this week. So that's a good start, isn't it? So if you can join us on Thursday, or if you like information about how you can join us, just let myself or Gordon or Stuart know. So let's commit ourselves to the Lord in prayer, shall we? And Father, we pray that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit might be our experience, both now and evermore, and that will help us to run with perseverance the race that you have marked out for us. Just bless us as we go from here. Bless us in the week ahead. We bring to you our family, our friends. We bring to you various members of the church family. For those who have had particularly difficult 2020s, may they know that you are with them and give us that strength and encouragement we need to persevere in the year that lies ahead. We commend ourselves to you and bring our thanks and our praise. In Jesus' name, amen.